chapter that we talked about last month in Direct Sales for Dummies. Because the sales are proving that consultants are wanting to do that business, but the decline in shows is proving that we need to do some group-wide training on getting more shows secured. So with that entrance, I just want to have some highlights from you guys on your August or something that you think triggered it. And then we're going to segue into a conversation about that booking chapter and how we can use that in our teams. And Jeannie, I saw you put your hand up. So you can start, my dear.
You're on mute, Jeannie.
Got to unmute yourself.
Thanks, Karen. Got it. Thank you.
There you go.
My question is, Anne, does that include catalog shows? Does it go up as far as a show when we designate it as a catalog show?
It does for that report that I'm talking about. It was the total number of shows submitted.
Okay, so that included catalog. Okay, because I think a lot of us are doing more virtual parties, so that was part of where my question came. Actually, I had a pretty darn good August for not doing very many shows. So I don't know if we have online orders or I'll pull up my stats as I talk because I wasn't really prepared for this. But yeah, I don't know what the answer is to that either, Anne, but I had a really good August, but didn't do a lot of shows.
Well, and that's kind of the gist of my opening, Jeannie, is that seems to be the case for our whole organization, because otherwise our sales would not have been up, even though our number of shows was drastically down. But that number of shows reports to me now anytime a consultant clicked a show when they set it up. So it's all the kinds of shows that includes them all. So that is what we're seeing. So,
Amanda. Yeah. Sorry, I'll just have to say that my stats reflect that. I don't know what else to add unless you have a specific question for me, Anne.
Okay. No, it's just a conversation.
Okay.
But with, with anybody that's on direct shipped, like I have 4 shows that all the orders have shipped and I'm being paid on those, but I have the host has still not closed out their orders. So does that skew? Also, the only thing I'm waiting on is for these hosts to.
Yes. So, did you guys all understand Amanda Jo's comment?
So, on direct ship, my orders can ship to people. So, I'm still getting paid on all those. So, my sales are in for them. But my host is not closed to ship. So my show average seems really high, but it's only because I haven't actually closed that show. But the sales are being counted for the previous, or for August.
Okay, so that definitely would affect it. But overall, in our own organization, I haven't seen the numbers since after conference when they opened that back up. But the masses of our teams are not on direction.
Okay.
So again, as we look at the whole
org,
that's not it either. So, but what else in August? Anybody here or on Zoom that's a highlight that you want to share? Or?
I have something.
Go, Karen.
Okay, so first I want to say that I think those numbers, that's an awesome number because it means that our show averages all went up. And so maybe that's a good thing. And I also had 3 parties that I had all the everything booked, but or everything shipped and in my stats. But because I'm in lead, I decided to wait till after midnight and submit the 3. So I have 3 of the shows already. So you know, I did that on purpose. But one of the other things for me is that my team sales were in the 8,000 range this time. And what made me really tickled was that half of that was my team. And a lot of times in August, I'm carrying the whole thing because no one else is working. So I was really thrilled that I actually had team members that were working this month.
Yeah. That's awesome, Karen. And that was very evident in us having additional directors being green this year, and the directors that were green had better team sales this year versus a year ago. So that definitely correlates to that. Could you tell, Karen, the bulk of your sales were coming from newer people?
Could I tell what?
Were the bulk of your team sales coming from newer team members?
Yeah. I just have recruited this in this year several people who really want to be Pampered Chef consultants, and I, in all my 90 recruits, I've never had one of those before, so.
That's awesome.
It is.
Yeah. Do you think the outlet being so juicy, this, like, you know, might have helped boost those sales? I think so. Yeah, good.
Yeah. The outlet, yeah.
It was just really juicy, and it kept flipping, you know, nicely.
Yes.
Okay. And I think that extra promotion.
Good. Who else has some thoughts on August or things they want to share?
I do. I love real-time reporting because our stats jumped almost $4,000 in an hour on Friday. Wednesday. And I also have a girl, Callie, on my team who's been to conference a couple years, who's committed to promoting to director, who had $4,500 in sales this month, plus she has a member on our team, so they hit over $5,000, so when she gets those other people, she'll be set up for director.
Oh, that's exciting.
Woo-hoo!
Yeah. Well, I'm excited. I got the direct ship. That was all new this month, so that was a little different, and I agree. I've got a couple hostesses that are closed, but then everybody's gotten their product, so they've been really happy with that because that's kind of all them. I have a gentleman on my team that didn't do anything for about 4 months, and he sent in $2,200. So that was really fun.
Whoa!
Yeah. He sent me a little text saying, "Well, I'm sending in $2,200." I go, "Wow!" So that was exciting. And then my other new team member, she sent over $1,000. So I think that's where, you know, you're saying that what the new ones are more producing than the ones that have been around for, you know, a few years. So. And that's really exciting, but I do really like the direct ship. That's been really different. I've been doing this for so long. I mean, it works great. They get your stuff right away. So,
good.
Yeah.
Shellen or Marty, Lynn, Aaron, anything about August?
I had a fun one. A mother called up and said, "You need to contact my daughter 3 hours away." I did. We did a 1300 Facebook show. And her sister booked off of her in August also. And we did like a $600 show. And that was
awesome.
A kitchen. I was excited because my August was looking very thin before they came along. Blessings from above.
Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Okay, I can't tell if I'm muted or unmuted. my summer was not good at all, but I'm back on track. I will say my team carried our team through the summer. So that's kind of exciting because I don't know the last time I could ever say that my sales were bad, but my teams were really good. So,
yeah. And anything to attribute that to, Shellen? Is it new people or just people that were doing business or...
I think both. I mean, I feel like everybody here is new just because I do have people in Wisconsin still. And I do think a couple of them submitted, but I mean, it's mostly people in Indiana that I've recruited within the last year. I have one girl that wants to be a director. And she is consistent at like 25 to 3,500, maybe 35 is kind of high, but she's a go-getter. And as Karen said, she's my first person I've ever met who's just really a go-getter. So, yeah, she's like the team cheerleader.
That is awesome. And Karen and Shellen, maybe you guys should somehow hook up your people virtually so you could be working with them together to really get them going. That's super.
Absolutely.
Lynn or Aaron,
I don't have much to say about August because my August was a flop. So I did not contribute to those numbers much.
You have a new team member?
I do have a new team member. That was interesting. I just refreshed the email on my phone and got an email that said I had a new team member. And it was like, okay. So I tried to call her. She didn't answer. I texted her. She texted right back. And she was one that just decided to do it and got on PamperChef.com and started signing up, searched zip code, and kind of randomly picked me. So I'll take that.
Absolutely. What a great ending to the month. That was fun.
Yeah, for sure.
Yeah?
For sure.
Good. Lynn, anything from you?
Okay, my team sales was okay. My personal sales was good because I only did three parties. Last party, I have my host that's possibly interested. So that came from a fair I did at the beginning. Other than that, that's it.
Okay. Cindy, Lori, Joan, anybody else here?
We had good just participation. 70% of the team submitted. So nice.
That's awesome.
Not great right. numbers, but 200 or more, right? Which is nice. So.
Yeah.
Nice active count.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
Old, new, everybody. Yes.
Awesome. Well, I had a crazy good summer personally because I had a lot of fun vacations that I was on. the sales that I had this summer were impressive to me because I wasn't home much. And I tried to stay in contact with my team over the summer. And I don't have anyone that has sold gangbusters, but they contributed. So just, staying in contact and now going into fall, trying to get them all excited and trying to get them to understand that it's not going to happen overnight, that just because you're on the phone now doesn't mean you're going to have 10 shows in September, so they don't give up hope.
Right.
So we seem to be on a positive note rolling forward.
You did a booking blitz.
Yeah, I did that the other night.
Well, Lynn didn't mention it, but I did get to spend a couple of days with Lynn and her team and her and doing some quality one-on-one. So, like that. And I did a pay it forward where we all made freezer meals and gave the meals out to people that had a big response. And I did another one for an orphanage in Africa this month in a freezer meal one. And that was a good success, too.
That was interesting.
Very cool. Okay. Marty, I'm just going to put a shout out to you. I'm very excited to road trip with Cindy to come.
I'm so excited.
So that is really fun coming up in October. And that is something that I'm hoping to do more often. And as I look at you, Jeannie and Karen and Shelen, and you're so long distance, but maybe putting a road trip on our schedule, and maybe I can convince another director that wants to share the time and share the ideas. It might be a fun thing to do, to have a touch point with your team. So I'm doing kind of a trial run with going to Wichita and Arkansas City, Kansas with Marty and her group via Cindy's team. So we'll kind of keep you updated on that too. So I think that's fun. I'm really excited how the feedback has come back from Zoom. I know it's not perfect, and I know it's only an hour, but the touch point's still really good to be able to see you, to give you a thumbs up, to hear from you. That's exciting. And thanks, Jeannie. And I want to segue to the bookings, but before I do that, I'm always worried about running out of time for you guys. And one of the things I wanted to make sure I heard from today, and I will get this group that's here in person after we're off of Zoom, but on the 12th, 13th, 14th, and 15th, I am at Chairman Circle and Executive Seminar, and we're always to come with a list of questions or topics that we want to make sure are addressed or come up or see if I can get an answer to. And we already picked up a couple this morning just in chatter here. But I'm wondering if any of you have anything that you want me to inquire about or share about or check on, and I'll add it to my list.
What were some of the things that you guys talked about just to get our minds going?
Well, this was just briefly, I didn't bring it up as a topic yet, but there's a download video issue going on. To be able to download the videos from home office and post them onto Facebook. Some people are having to put them into YouTube first and then re-download them. But if you're taking them from the party packs, I'm not having that trouble. I can go right into Facebook. We need to get that fixed. Home office wants that easy. I didn't realize there was an issue going on. So I'm going to bring that up. Was there a second thing?
Yeah, the October products that are coming out, you can't find the prices on them online anywhere. And everyone's like, will you buy those packs? Well, our teams don't want to do that. They want to print off one sheet and share that around. And I know it's in your little recipe guide for success, but again, they're not going to carry that little thing around either. They just need a full-size sheet to print off, because your part-timers are going to print one of those and share it as a special. Mm-hmm.
I think it's more difficult to find things on the new web. And I find myself doing a lot more searching because things just aren't where they seem practical to be.
Yeah, like you're thinking it should be here, but it's way in something else.
Yeah. I don't know, maybe it's just me, but I see a lot of that on Facebook. Someone saying, hey, does anyone know where this is or that is? And so it just seems to be more complicated than instead of simple. Mm-hmm.
Okay, so you guys on the phone.
When I want to download the recipes from Season's Best so I can send them to my host, I used to be able just to save them in a file. Now I have to copy and paste it and open a new tab so I can paste it. And it used to be where, now they'll let you, email it? Well, I don't want to email it. I want to send it in with some other things. So they've changed that tab. You know what I'm talking about?
Why don't you want to email it?
I'm putting it in a letter with other things.
Oh. But they also have where there's the icon to email it, but then right to the left of that is the print, so that it's in a print copy versus what you see on the screen. It cleans it up.
I haven't clicked on that. So, Cindy, if I click on that, then it will show me the copy.
It's in a format that is printable, nice looking on one page.
And that's what I'm wanting.
Yeah.
But
last night I wanted to send that by private message.
Uh-huh.
And there's no way to do it by private message. And I do so much of my business by private message. So I ended up copying and pasting, and it wasn't nearly as pretty as it would have been
right. If
I had had a formatted copy.
Yeah, and when you copy and paste it into a private message on Facebook, it's all like you have to go through and take time to format it because
right.
You can't read it otherwise.
You guys, just to clarify for me for asking, is this the Season's Best recipes only or all recipes now?
It's all recipes. And it's specifically to Facebook, putting it in a private message.
Okay, what else?
So I have something that's been bothering me for years that I'm about to post about. Catalogs, one after another, they look identical.
Yes.
And they're all ugly. Are we afraid of color at the Pamper Chef? Every time I look at the catalogs, I feel sad. I think the inside of them is beautiful, but the outside, this is the last three times, and they all look just like the other.
It is so difficult to tell one season from the next when you start a new season.
That's right.
I definitely agree.
I'm just so sad every time I see the cover that they afraid to, like this new one, we could have put a colored sweater on this person or something. I don't know. It's not pretty at all. And they all look identical to each other. And so, as Shalyn said, it's hard to find, like, which one is this season's, and I haven't put away last season's yet, and I don't know which ones I'm looking at, because they're all the same. Anyway, it's a big frustration.
Okay, so I want to ask Karen and Shalyn, I think you were speaking up right away. Have you guys emailed that feedback to marketing?
I don't know who to say it to.
Marketing.
I have sent emails before saying who does the catalog covers. I need to talk to somebody, but But I, you know, I don't have any idea.
So they need to go to the marketing department. And if you look on the website under the contact stuff, contact us stuff, it gives you different categories and different departments. And the test kitchen and the marketing people, it's about a 50-50. And the funding, like all the, I'm going back to the window and all the numbers and documents that we've shared on the funding is all these space coloring.
You know what, Anne, we don't have to hear you suddenly.
The microphone all of a sudden is bad.
If you guys try muting, we'll cancel it.
How about everybody try to mute a second? See if we lose the echoing.
It's better now.
Let's mute Erin. Can we just mute her? Erin, we're going to just try to mute you just for a minute because I think it's your phone giving the feedback.
Okay, I have myself muted, but I can, you can double mute me if you want to.
Just you, we'll unlock you in a little bit and see if that was
okay.
Okay. So, Karen, in all the documents over the last year that were shared, the test kitchen and the marketing department, it's about a 50-50 weight. And the trending, which they're trying to be much more current and trending, in homeware is all neutrals. And that's why we're in the whole neutral game right now. That's why all these products this year were in the neutrals. Now, go 180 degrees, and the mini catalog covers have been starkly different because they can change them more financially, fiscally, easily. But it's feedback that we've shared at meetings. I totally hear you on the similarities, but they're not getting enough feedback on that line. So that's why I asked you specifically if you guys had emailed. And I will do, after today's call, I will put an email out on the Facebook page to our whole director team on a couple places that you should send that feedback directly. Okay? Jeannie?
Yeah, Karen, I'm totally with you and what you're saying is because I like color. My house has lots of color. But there's how many of us on this call, whether Zoom or at Ann's, and I think I can count Amanda Jo and Erin out, but how many of us in here are 48 and older or older?
Yeah, lots of us.
Yeah. And I think I'm like 10 years older than what I just said, but
I was going to say, I think you're close to my age.
Yeah. Because you know, every time I go into the newer homes, oh my goodness, everything is the color of our products, everything. And whenever I talk to a younger person, like maybe in their 20s or 30s, maybe early 40s, they love the graystone. And I'm like, but I don't say that to them. So, but Karen, I'm totally with you. I understand what you're saying. But I think it's one of those millennial things.
It's just that I think that the catalog should look different from one season to the next, number one. And I agree that I think that the tools would pop if they were put against color. I mean, you can't see that bowl at all. If you're just glancing at it, you don't realize she's showing a beautiful new piece of stoneware because it just is all faded. It just does not pop in any way. And really, it's been a pet peeve of mine for my whole 10 years with Pampered Chef. I only remember one cover of all the catalogs we've ever done, and that's the one of the grilled pizza. Because it had green grass in the background. All the rest of them have looked brown or gray or brown or gray. And I don't see any reason why we can't have a little color, just a little. It doesn't have to be like my house, but it needs a little something.
So Karen, is your feedback the same on the mini catalogs?
About half the mini catalogs are not memorable and about half of them are.
Okay.
So they do better with minis.
So I have it. I will give also follow up with an email, but I think you guys all need to say that. But Jeannie is very spot on we are trending younger than what the majority of us are, and we need to be very aware of that. So what else do you want brought up?
I also think that's why they brought out this kid stuff this fall, is to get to this younger generation who have young kids and start bringing that audience into our base.
Well, I have to think that the 27 to 35 generation was the 8 to 12-year-old generation when we first started. Mm-hmm. So that was 20 years ago. So they're trying to re-engage the child that grew up with Pampered Chef to now be the person who introduces it to their generation. And that's a great way to do that with that high quality. Because I think parents these days want to invest in a high quality product. They want to invest in something that's, you know, earth friendly and has all these things. And so I think it's a great introduction into that. People with that income in that age group that were Pampered Chef children themselves, reintroducing them now as a parent to their child and getting them re-inspired. Yeah.
There was actually two driving forces on the kids' line. One was to re-engage the 35-year-old parent. Two is to have a quality product purchasable for the 65-year-old grandparent that's used to Pampered Chef quality that feels like they have everything. So there was two driving forces. Mm-hmm. So those are two things you want to use in your marketing of it.
Mm-hmm. That's a great. And I think a lot of kids cook. I mean, a lot of them are home alone, yep, and they cook. They are like trying to find something that they can use that's safe and, you know, yeah, high quality.
Instead of eating a bag of chips. Yep.
Okay, I have a question.
They want to explore more.
Yep. Okay, Lynn.
Okay, well, first of all, just to tap in on what you guys have been discussing. I'm probably the oldest here, Jeannie. I love the new colors. I love the gray. I love the taupe. It's chic. It looks great. I love it. People just got to get on board with it. As far as the color of the catalog, I agree. They've all been alike. You could change the color of the sweater. Otherwise, it's a great looking front cover. As far as the new products, I had the really, at the two fairs I did in end of July and beginning of August, I took the bright colors and sat them on my front counter. So I took the kids' stuff. Tons of interest. Actually, just submitted over $500 of pre-orders from people that ordered the popcorn popper, the kids' baking set, and the whipped cream maker. Seemed to be the hottest, but those are the ones I had in front of everybody. I didn't take the kids' pizza set because I didn't have room. What they did want is, why can't these be sold separate? I had older people, really interested in the lightweight green bowl, bluish green bowl, you know, the kids' baking bowl, because it was so lightweight. I had people interested in the little scraper with the smiley face on it, the little, instead of the black nylon mini serving, oh, why can't we get this one? So I don't know if they'll ever do it, but there is interest in that set being sold separately. But the question I have is totally off the wall from all these products. It's about the direct ship program. I'm not in it. Eventually, I know I will be, because we all will be. Question I have is, what is Pampered Chef? Do we have any idea what Pampered Chef's decision is going to be on if you're at a party and the host and the guest just wants her order shipped to the host? Are they still going to be able to get that $5.25 shipping for? I know it's only a $2 break, but I'll tell you what, in my neck of the woods over here, $2 must mean a lot, because they still want to. And I know there's a huge difference, because I did a show down in Ankeny last spring for my niece, and people that lived across the street paid the $7.25. It was like no problem. Up here, you know, you can say, oh, it'll come straight to your home, but they'll still go back to, but I'll take the $5.25 and have it shipped to my host.
Here's what I say, Lynn. I've been telling them Pampered Chef's shipping has gone up, like shipping all across the country has gone up. But what's cool is ours didn't just go up, but it now went up, and they ship it directly to you. So I don't even tell them that, well, 525 is not available to any of them. So I just tell them, just like everything on up.
I don't say anything. They see it on their form.
Yeah.
Because I still have them write out a order form, you know, pass those out, they put their names on them.
A couple things, Lynn. I don't have the answer, and Home Office does not have the answer yet. Will we always allow orders to be shipped up to the host at a reduced rate? I can tell you that we are subsidizing the direct ship program right now with only having bumped it $2 an order. However, the customer satisfaction from all the surveys that are going out, which it doesn't hurt to mention at your shows to your customers, hey, you may get an email follow-up from Home Office making sure things, because they're doing a lot of those. But the satisfaction with the direct ship now is so high, and the survey work is that they would have paid even more to have gotten it direct shipped to them and that quickly. And it's all in the marketing of, because I'm just as rural as you are, and I don't bring it up. You can print order forms without the shipping on it now, which is what a lot of people have gone to, that they personally are hung up on it, felt like it was an issue. But it's not going to go away. And so probably that for even if you're not in the program right now and it's a transition that you're going to go into, it's going to become a fact of the way that we do business because the customers are driving it that way. So it's just like getting on board with a color or whatever. Get yourself on board so that you're ready for it when it goes is my suggestion number one. Number two is, I think Karen's philosophy was a nice way to handle it. You know, if you want to talk about it, shipping's gone up, but our change was it went up with direct shipment right to your house. That's fine. I frankly don't talk about shipping at all. I just do their orders, and I get a lot of messages back. They're so shocked that they got their order in 3 days because they heard that Shellen wasn't closing her show until Friday. And so I think it's all in it. So this whole thing has been such a huge, huge learning situation. But the end results are, even though we're financially subsidizing it right now, that probably means the price will go up again. But it also means that's the way we're going to go because the customer satisfaction is bringing them back. And it has been proven that there's now an actual trail of people that ordered at a show, got their products, and ordered again and got their products before the host ever closed her show.
Sorry, Anne, I thought you were done.
Go ahead, Shellen.
Do you know when they're going to open that up again for us to sign up for it? Because I'm not in it, and I really wish I was.
No, because they did a huge group with everybody at conference.
Yeah.
So now we've got to let that settle. One of the big factors of this is that they're still tracking, is in order for our warehouse to go 100% to this, we actually have to change a lot of infrastructure.
Right.
So what they're tracking is what is the two most common sized packages that need to go out that go via direct shipment. You know, is it the smallest box? Is it a pouch? You know, what is it? What's the most common two sizes? Because that's the majority of the infrastructure that has to get built. And so now that we've got that big pool from conference added on, now we're getting numbers really fast. But it'll be a while. I mean, I would say probably at least this season you won't see another group come in.
Okay.
So.
Rich Havla's retirement came at an interesting time.
Yeah, you know, we actually kind of begged Rich to stay the last 2 years, Jeannie. He was pretty ready to retire, and I don't blame him. He's been just a godsend. But he was willing to give Tracy a couple years and help her go. And he actually, I can remember at one of my first Chairman Circle meetings 6 years ago, he was an advocate then that we had to get shipping to the customers. He's been completely on board.
He's been through a lot.
Yeah. Yep.
Yeah.
And now he's at the lake most of the time. Lucky him.
Yeah.
Other things for Home Office. That's a great question, Lynn. And that's as much info as I can tell you, but I will bring it up again to see if I learn something new.
Can I add something, just one more thing with that?
Let's wait. Let's look at those guys.
Okay. Sounds
yeah.
Okay.
Anything, Marty, Karen, Shelly, Jeannie? Erin, we could unlock Erin. Erin's muted, Cindy. I'm going to pop up and unlock her. We'll unlock you, Erin. Hang on.
Try screaming.
Okay, Erin, you're free.
This is like the quietest version of me you ever get, right?
Yeah.
Just keep me mute. If I had a mute button at the actual meeting, you'd be in good shape. Most of the stuff I was going to say, you just got done saying, and with the direct ship now, like, I haven't said the number, the price at things. I've kind of made them feel like, because I've been calling it a pilot and making those guests feel like, whoa, I get this and other people don't. And I have not had one single person squawk about the price of it. And being able to like call and do customer care calls before you even close the show is kind of absurd. So I'm loving that. And then I love the neutral stuff. I'll put that out there. So I think it is true that they're jumping on board with what's trending, not everybody's going to like it, but you have to pick the thing that we think the most people are going to like. I don't know that I have any other like things to talk to home office about, I guess.
I just want to say that I don't have any issues with neutrals, just neutral felt covers.
Oh, okay.
Yep, I got it, Karen.
Because neutral is a color.
Karen, I don't think you have an issue with neutral colors. I think you have an issue with every cover looking exactly the same.
Yes. Well, but I also, the neutral colors, they're afraid to put anything on the cover except tan or gray.
But you like the grass.
Oh, I love the grass.
And that's all they
needed.
Colorado.
Need in-
Okay, let's move on. Let's go back to, before we go to chapter 10, I want to go backwards to chapter 7 and that bookings chapter that was so insightful and had so much good information. And I know a couple ways people have been working through this chapter with their teams, but I want to just put it back out there on discussion about using this chapter. And what else? What else can we be doing at our team meetings, whether they're virtual or in person, to build the confidence to continue to build bookings? Is there anything from this chapter yourself that hit home? Did you take action on it to somebody besides yourself? That's kind of the topic I want to have before we go to 10, because that's the segue. Once you have the booking, it's all about the host coaching and the training the host.
I just met with one of my consultants that came with me to conference, and I asked her what would be productive for her at a team meeting. And she told me that she loves it when we do a new recipe, and you know, we're working with new products, because a lot of them don't have all of the products like we do. So I decided to take that one step farther. And at our next team meeting, we're going to decide what recipe we would do in October. And then everyone is going to be assigned to come back with a unique thing to use a specific tool for, or if the recipe has a quirk ingredient that we in the Midwest aren't familiar with, I want someone to do some searching on the internet and find out benefits for an ingredient that's in the recipe. So we have, you know, more things to take with us to our shows. Because guests love it when you come with tips about a food or something like that. So I just thought that would be a way that we can boost our training and get everyone involved.
And add to that, after the nationwide call, is when they bring the recipe, they come with the tip about the food, but they also need to come with a selling tip, recruiting tip, and a booking tip on how they'd use it in a show.
So give an example, Cindy, of that scenario. So use what you brought today. So you brought...
Okay, so today I brought the weekend chili in the new Rock Crock. And so the tip would be that you could use the Dutch oven or the everyday pan for smaller family size, or the Dutch oven for a tailgate or a large family grouping for the holidays. A recruiting tip is this would be, thinking on the spot. Bookings, of course, would be, you know, give them lines to use to host a show to get the Rock Crock for free. So you would demo it at a show, entice them to book a show so they could get it in their house. Selling it, I would just say every home has to have it. So whether you buy it outright and have a show to get it or become a consultant, every home has to have it. So the value of it, selling the feature, you know, the benefits, what it would mean to the families. You know, actually give examples of, you know, if you have the young ones, how this could be a one-pot dinner. Give those. The recruiting is just.
It comes in the kit now. I mean, that's a choice.
Yeah, comes in the kit. Yeah. So.
Good job.
Yeah, that's good. Yeah, it brings it full circle.
What else from this chapter or action that you've taken?
So one of the things that keeps coming up that it just hits me in the face is how we schedule our shows by offering limited time and dates to our hostesses. We talked about this on Bookings 201. You know, I've done this for years, and I just assume everybody does this, but I think they don't. You know, with a week, like a Tuesday or a Thursday, we're looking at your calendar first and then taking them on. So I thought a fun role play would be at your meeting is to have your new consultant just walk through, and let's say Carol's the doctor's office, and Amanda Jo is the oil change, and Anne is a paper chef show. And so if you were to make a phone call into your doctor's office and you need to get in because you're really sick, what does the doctor office say? Can you come at 3 o'clock or 4 o'clock? And if you want to get an oil change, Amanda Jo says, can you come on Monday at 2 or can you come at, and then we have a real strong Pampered Chef consultant say, you know, if you want to host a show with me, can you do it on Tuesday or Thursday? And prove the point that every day in our life, we are providing a service that is offered a time and date that fits into mm-hmm. their schedule, as is your business, and show them to role play that. And then you can move the people around and have the new consultant be the Pampered Chef consultant. Or you can move it however you wanted to, but to hear the words say, hey, I'd love to have you come into the office. We have an appointment today at 3 or 4. And make it real life, you know. Exactly. When do you want to come for your parent-teacher conference? Do you want to come on Tuesday at 3 o'clock, or do you want to come? So I just thought it was going to be a fun way, again, to try to teach time management to get business into their lives versus trying to work their life around
their business. Yeah.
Their life in, you know what I mean, kind of get the business into there. So that was just an idea I had. I thought maybe I'd try to implement that in my next team meeting with my team. So
At my meeting last time, we talked about, they said, well, we can't get bookings, you know, can't get catalog shows. So I say, well, if you don't have a booking, what should we do? Let's kind of write down where would we go to get one. Let's kind of think out of the box. And I've done that numerous times with myself. I got cancellations. I got to get something filled in, or so we just sat down and we mentioned about you know, let's say if you go to a grocery store, you know, what would you say? Or you know, looking into how about calling some schools or daycare centers for a fundraiser. So just giving a list of things to help them thinking out of the box, because they say, well, my canceled my show. That's it. You know, they just don't know what to do or where to go. So we have, you know, I'm trying to give them ideas and so hopefully, you know, to help them along, but, you know.
In the meetings library, there's an A to Z program for that so that you take it to your team meeting to come up with who you would host. But we did the new product reveal, and for every new product that was brought out, who would be interested? Who could you take this to and show them who would want to have a show with this, and then put names by those. So for every new product, they have someone they have to contact.
So Cindy and I took the Bookings Chapter 7 and begged Anne to help us
And
begged.
It was begged. We really just asked. But we broke it into three sections and put it out to our teams as bookings 101, bookings 201, and bookings 301 to wrap up August into September to get them a solid fall schedule. And we've offered incentives each time. So we set it up as a Facebook event to be able to invite them that way. We each took one of the training dates, and then we record it on Zoom. So we post the Zoom call for them to join. They join, we do the training, we do some Q&A, and then they would have to report back in 48 hours with their results. And then we give them a prize. And yeah, I've been impressed by the number of people that have been on it. So, and I've been impressed with the people who watch the recording also. And so they have some really good results. And some of them, it gives you a really valid, good point to talk through how they are doing their bookings. And so,
yeah. And some of you have followed along on it, some of you haven't, but I would really encourage you to pair up with somebody, or you could teach them yourself to your team. But pairing up three made it easy. But the thing that was been interesting to me, since they set it up on a Facebook event, Cindy and Amanda Joe did all this work. I just did one of the trainings and we invited our teams. The thing that's been really fun and eye-opening to me was we asked them to post their booking contacts in 48 hours with results of those contacts. And so many of them were so random. Well, I've been making calls. Well, I've been making contacts. And so it was easy for me to be able to the person say, well, that's great, Shellen, but how many calls did you make tonight? And how many contacts did you make tonight? Remember, the challenge to win the Target gift card is to give us a specific number of contacts so we can see the results. And some of the people that posted those types of very vague, well, I've been making calls, or I've talked to everybody at work. It was like, okay, when and who's everybody? And it gave us a way to nonchalantly say to them, you've got to be more specific. You're thinking about it, or you think you're making contacts. And one of the people on my own team, she had said, well, I made a couple of calls. So then I said, well, how many calls do you make? She's like, four, and I booked one show. It's like, okay, we wanted specific. So I told her, that is amazing to have only made four calls and to have dated one show. So all the other people are reading these too, and that has been as valuable as the actual information in the 30-minute call. We train for 15 or 20 minutes and give them 10 minutes for questions. And I think, I haven't checked 201 yet, but 101, I think we had like 20-ish on, and more than that have watched the video. So that's been fun that they're doing it. But they're not specific enough, and this is what you're going to find when you work with your team. They're saying, oh, yeah, I've made calls.
How many calls?
Okay. How many?
Anyway, and then I got sick.
So I think, you know, doing this Zoom has brought that out, but I think then taking and saying a work night and we're all going to make calls together. Booking blitz or whatever, but one-on-one, if they have to come to your house to do it, I think we're going to have to handhold to get them to make more than two calls and say they've called everybody.
Well, there's been a lot of interaction on that too. Like someone that was on may have not had very good success and someone else had a lot of success. So then that person that had poor success might comment on the one that got a lot of responses. So what did you say? Or what time did you do that? Or
so you can build some great new ideas, fresh ideas, and that's what they're looking for.
It gives you an idea of who's really determined and who wants more, and then you know who to talk to.
Yeah. Yep, exactly. Jeannie?
I love hearing what you guys are saying. I need help. I'm very thankful because my attendance at my team meetings is up, but I have offered training via Zoom, via Facebook, you know, all kinds of stuff in between our meetings, and I get no response. Nobody wants to do it, or they don't respond, and I don't know, maybe I need to make some phone calls or personal texts.
I'll tell you, I have found that doing a virtual team meeting on top of your live team meeting, kind of like a Facebook party, I mean, I don't know. I think people don't want to necessarily be like this either, because then they need to like sit and commit. Do you know what I'm saying? But when I do a virtual team meeting, I started doing them a couple months ago. They are so active on them, and they love them. And it doesn't stop them from coming to the live meeting.
No, I'm saying my live meetings are good. I can't get anybody to show interest. So what are you guys doing to get them to these additional meetings? Whether it be Zoom or Facebook or what?
You're having good attendance.
Excuse me?
Why do you feel the need to do these Facebook meetings and such if you're having good attendance? Are there still some not attending?
I guess just to keep them going throughout the month, Cindy.
So, Jeannie, a couple things that I do is every coaching call I mentioned, like we talked that we're going to do this. So I mentioned there's going to be a booking training coming up that I'd love for you to join on. And it doesn't mean everybody. That's the nice thing when you pair with other teams, because then you get enough people that it looks like there's enough participants. And the other thing that we do is we run them from 8 p.m. to 9 p.m. so that if they have shows, they can still get on. Plus, we do the recording. So why not just schedule it and see what you have, if you have people on?
Pair up with another group.
I've done that too, and nobody.
A lot of this booking one, they were afraid of figuring out Zoom and couldn't get it. I mean, we've done a lot of hand-holding and talking and getting people on it. Once they're on, it's like, oh, my gosh, you know. So we start doing Zoom at our in-live team meetings so that they see how it works, and it just builds from there.
I think, too, like anything else, it's just being consistent and doing it over and over and over again. And eventually people are going to realize, oh, I should be doing this. And they will join and you will get participation. But just doing it.
That's helpful. Something that just popped into my head is, why not ask my audience? Yeah. You know, at a meeting.
Tell them you've been challenged by your upline to do some virtual, online, Zoom, whatever, and so you need their help.
Okay.
And once they've done it once, then they'll be like, oh, this wasn't hard, and it's easy, or it was beneficial, or...
Amanda Jo did a mock virtual show for our teams, and so everybody was invited to the mock show on Facebook. They had to come if they wanted to learn how to do it. It was all strictly training. You could do a booking blitz night virtually. You could do, you know, some kind of a theme training. Then have them share what they learned. I learned on Zoom. I picked this up on Zoom at the meetings. So that people, maybe I should go on Zoom. You know, you just have to build, like Shellen said.
Okay, that helps. Thank you, guys.
The other thing too, Jeannie, like when I did the mock virtual, it was posting in the background, but I was going Facebook Live and saying, okay, so what do you need to know? What is your struggle? Because I have no idea what Cindy's level of people are, which made it really easy. I know for the most part the level of my team, but I had some really simple questions that's what was holding them back, and I could just flip my computer and show them exactly how to do it and walk through, and if they didn't understand it, we just went through it again. And so it was really, really simple. And it was only about an hour of my time.
Okay. I'm willing to do it if people want it. I got to find out why they're not wanting it. Okay. Thank you.
The other thing, Jeannie, some feedback I've gotten from my own team members and a couple that have done booking 101 and booking 201 now, they loved that we kept it on a half hour and under. And one of them is somebody that's watched the video both times, because that time just does not work in her life with little kids. That's bedtime. And she's like, I can stay engaged that long, and I've learned a couple great tips each time. So maybe to start getting this rolling for people, maybe you do 20-minute virtual trainings and record it so that you can post it on your team page. And then you'll see some people watching it that way. Sometimes I think, oh, if I'm going to take the time, I want to do an hour training. But I am finding, you know, 15 and 20 minute segments, I'm getting such better feedback than hour long. Now the mock virtual party that Amanda Jo led and Cindy's team was in, that pretty much is driven by how much time you need to take to teach everybody what they're needing to do. But when it's a topic like bookings 101, or maybe the topic is how to sell the rock crocs, because your team maybe isn't, you know, doesn't have the same sales confidence as you do, that could be a short thing. They could be on live, but record it, and those who aren't on live, and maybe you only get two or three on live, but maybe another six watch it or something. I think that's part of the way that our leadership is going. So just a little feedback on it.
Okay. Thanks, ladies.
Yeah. And we're almost out of time, you guys, and we didn't talk about chapter 10 with you guys at all. But so before we have to stop that recording and it cuts us off, is there one highlight any of you would throw out about host coaching that that just really resonated that you're going to remind your team about?
You know what? Something that I wanted to share that I read in a big old thread that somebody else may have read that really hit home to me, especially with reading this too, is, you know, hosts are so concerned about what their friends are getting out of their parties to actually host coach your host on what their friends are getting out of it as opposed to just what they're getting out of it. And to really change that thought, I just thought that struck me as so smart. And I mean, obviously it's important to talk about the guest specials, but I don't think I really, you know, I throw in your token, it's going to be such a fun night and everybody, you know, to get out and this and that, but to really hit home and what their friends are getting out of it, I thought was very enlightening to me.
Yep, I would agree, Shalyn. Aaron, Marty, Karen, anybody else, chapter 10, a real highlight?
My only highlight was that I decided I needed to just keep going on my Zoom calls that I started with talking about the booking chapter, because as I've read this one, I thought, okay, this is good too. Oh, I should share this too. Oh, I need to tell them this too. So I just think that I'm going to just keep going. So
awesome.
Test your business 10 times, really. Like, I would have been a three-time toucher, you know, but that schedule was really good to see her 10 times touch.
Yes.
Because I'm like, I could do that. That 10 times touch would be good.
Yes.
That was fun.
Easy fun to train, too.
Yeah, yeah, and easy and very quick.
Yeah. Yes.
Which I think a lot of times post coaching can seem heavy.
Yes. Yeah.
So since you're short on time, for those of you on Zoom, do take the time to really absorb chapter 10 if you haven't. Because it's as good as chapter 7. Both are critically important to your teams, so figure out a way for you that works to thread the information down to them. And then October is only chapter 11 because of the good stuff that there is. And then I just wanted to mention October 7th's call. The main goal of October 7th is we will be talking about how to run a holiday workshop for your team so that you can do this at your November meeting again this year. Some people did it. Shalyn went to one last year from a peer director. But we want to talk about actually running that holiday workshop for your team and the topics that you'll want to train on and the delegation that you'll want to do. So, for example, you're going to have different stations is probably the easiest way to visualize it. Who on your team could do and train the station well to teach three fun holiday beverages they could promote at their November and December shows? Or who on your team could train well at the station of what to do to bridge your business over from December into January? Or who on your team could train quickly on how to do a cookies exchange party? So you want to be thinking about all those topics, because one of the goals we want at the October meeting is for you to leave the call prepared with that list of topics. You pick your date, you pick your time, you pick the length it needs to be, but then you know you can be thinking about who you can assign to what. So So that's a little bit of homework. So be thinking about all your topics that you would like to have trained on. Okay? I think we need to let you go because I think we hit the record a couple minutes late, but we're a couple minutes late. So thank you, you guys.
Bye. Bye, guys.
Thank you. Bye.
You can pick it up and drop it.
Made me nervous.
It's gonna fly.
Hey, Cindy.